Randomized control trials, or RCTs, are one of two designs that are eligible for review under the WWC Group Design Standards. In an RCT, a study randomly assigns units to two or more groups. In a simple RCT, one group receives the intervention and the other serves as a comparison group. The units assigned might be individuals, such as teachers or students, or they might be clusters or groups, like classes or schools. Ideally, randomization should create similar groups, which means groups that are similar on both observed and unobserved characteristics. An observed characteristic is something we can measure or record, such as gender or test scores, whereas an unobserved characteristic is something such as motivation that is not or cannot be directly measured. Why does the WWC prefer groups that are similar? When groups have similar characteristics at the beginning of a study, then we have confidence that any differences we see in outcomes between the groups are due to the intervention that they received. When groups are not similar, then these pre-existing differences could be responsible for the outcomes. This is the advantage of randomized controlled trials. We can be reasonably confident that the intervention caused the measured impact. Of course, randomization doesn't always go smoothly. The WWC has two criteria for well-executed randomization. First, the study must assign units, such as students or teachers, entirely by chance. For example, a study might use a random process like a series of coin flips to do this. When units are assigned to groups based on a series of coin flips, belonging to the intervention group is unlikely to be related to other characteristics of the units, such as students' prior test scores or race, ethnicity. Other random assignment processes include those based on lotteries and random numbers generated by computers. However, some approaches to creating groups that might seem random may not actually be fully random. For example, a study might assign students who have birthdays in January to June to the intervention group and July to December to the comparison group. The WWC does not consider this to be well-executed random assignment. This is because research indicates that people with the same birthday may share similar characteristics. This is true for adults, but is especially true for young children. For example, using a month of birth to create groups in a kindergarten class might result in an intervention group with students who are relatively older than the students in the comparison group. The intervention students might perform better on the outcomes because they are older, and not only because they received the intervention. This is not random assignment. The key is for the assignment to occur entirely by chance. We also sometimes see studies that use class schedules to assign students to conditions. But relying on class schedules doesn't count as random assignment. Think about when you were in high school. If you were a member of the band, then you likely had most of the band members in your classes throughout the day because that was the only way to make your schedules work. The problem with class schedules is that students with certain characteristics often take the same classes, so the groups are not truly random. Studies must also meet a second key criterion. Every unit in the analysis must have a chance of being assigned to each group. So, if a study randomizes students to three conditions, then every child must have the opportunity to be assigned to one of those groups. The study authors can't say Anita had the opportunity to be in one of three groups, but DeAndre only had the opportunity to be in one of two groups. It isn't well-executed randomization if DeAndre didn't have the possibility of ending up in the third group. The requirement that everyone must have a chance at assignment means that the analytic sample, which is the sample used in the analysis, cannot include anyone whom the study did not randomly assign. So if a researcher chooses to assign someone in the analytic sample to a particular condition, the WWC cannot review the study as a randomized controlled trial. This issue arises when researchers randomly assign some, but not all, students to conditions. For example, researchers may work with principals or teachers to assign a particular student to a group based on that student's needs. If the study is testing a behavior intervention and one student has significant behavior challenges, the study may purposely assign that student to the intervention group. Typically, researchers exclude these purposefully assigned units from the analysis. If so, then the study can be reviewed as an RCT. But if the study includes the student in the analytic sample, then the WWC cannot review it as an RCT. The WWC tends to accept an author's claims about random assignment. That is, we take their word for it if the authors say they used random assignment. However, the WWC looks for anything that suggests the study did not conduct well-executed random assignment. When the description in the study is incomplete, the WWC may contact the authors with questions. The WWC carefully reviews the entire text for a study, paying attention to how the authors describe the process, not just to the labels the authors use. Sometimes authors say only, students were randomly assigned, but later on they may say they included a student who was not actually randomly assigned, a sign that randomization may not have been well executed. However, the authors do need to say that they randomly assign units. Otherwise, the WWC assumes assignment was not random. Also, the WWC isn't concerned about who actually executed the random assignment, as long as there is no reason to believe that the study used a compromised randomization process. For example, some studies take advantage of a pre-existing lottery, such as those often conducted for charter school admissions, and the researchers had nothing to do with the random assignment process. That would be fine for the WWC. Some studies conduct a well-executed random assignment process, but something happens later that compromises the integrity of the design, meaning that differences may have been introduced between the intervention and comparison groups, and we are no longer confident that the intervention alone caused the measured impact. We've already discussed one way in which this can happen. When researchers include units in the analytic sample that were not randomly assigned, such as students assigned to the intervention condition because they had a special need, then according to the WWC, the random assignment process is compromised. Because compromised random assignment can introduce differences between the intervention and comparison groups, the WWC does not allow these studies to receive the highest rating of meets WWC group design standards without reservations. But this isn't the only way of compromising random assignment. Frequently, not all students assigned to the intervention actually receive the intervention, but the study still needs to analyze the students according to their assigned condition. For example, if the authors randomly assigned Justin to the comparison classroom, but the school principal later moved him to the intervention classroom to balance out the class sizes, the authors must analyze him as a comparison group student according to his original assigned condition. If Justin was instead analyzed as an intervention student, then according to the WWC, the random assignment is compromised. As another example, a student assigned to a school in the comparison group might move during the school year and end up in an intervention group school. The study must still analyze the student according to his assigned condition in the comparison group, even though he received the intervention condition. To be clear, a student assigned to the comparison condition who ends up receiving the intervention doesn't compromise random assignment, so long as the study analyzes the student according to his or her originally assigned condition. An analysis based on assigned conditions is sometimes called an intent to treat analysis because students are analyzed in their attended treatment condition. These intent to treat analyses preserve the integrity of the random assignment. A third way that a study can compromise random assignment is not assigning all units to receive the intervention with the same probability while at the same time not accounting for those differences. Using different probabilities in random assignment is relatively common, and the WWC accepts this approach as well-executed random assignment so long as it is accounted for in the analysis. We'll show an example of this kind of analysis shortly and explain what researchers need to do to account for it. There are other ways to compromise a well-executed random assignment process. We'll talk more about those in later modules when we cover related concepts, including sample attrition. Let's discuss a few acceptable RCT designs. In one acceptable design, units, such as students or teachers, volunteer to participate. Then the study randomly assigns those who volunteer to conditions. Volunteering might seem like a concern because there may be something different about people that causes them to volunteer. But if the study randomly assigns volunteers, whatever characteristics cause them to volunteer will be present and at about the same levels in both groups. The design essentially controls for those characteristics. Another fairly common acceptable design is stratified random assignment, or blocking. Researchers may identify particular characteristics that they want to make sure are present in both groups. For example, the study may stratify on gender, meaning that a group of students is first separated into two, one for boys and one for girls. Then random selection occurs within each of these two groups, or strata. Researchers use this strategy when they want to make sure the intervention and comparison groups have similar ratios of boys and girls. In that case, the researchers would block the students by gender and randomly assign them separately within the gender blocks. Study authors can block on just about any characteristic. They may also choose to block on multiple characteristics. For example, if the researchers want to make sure to have high, middle, and low-achieving students in both conditions, they could block by achievement and randomly assign students within those blocks. We often see studies that use different probabilities for randomization. Whereas using a fair coin toss to randomize students to conditions would assign approximately the same number of students to the intervention and comparison groups, other approaches that assign more students to one group than the other are also acceptable. In the example illustrated here, there are two strata, one group of schools that are making adequate yearly progress, or AYP, and another group that are not making AYP. For schools that are making AYP, the researchers used a 50-50 ratio for assignment, meaning they assigned schools using the equivalent of a fair coin toss. For those that are not making AYP, they used a 70-30 ratio for assignment, meaning that these schools were more likely to be assigned to the intervention group. The schools that are not making AYP were more likely to end up in the intervention group because there was a 70% chance that the study would assign them to that group. This is acceptable for the WWC. Studies do not have to use a 50-50 split for random assignment, and the probabilities of assignment can differ across study units. However, the study authors must account for the different probabilities in their analysis. We'll next discuss the options for doing this. If a study uses different probabilities for randomization, it must account for those different probabilities in the analysis to preserve the integrity of the random assignment. If the study does not account for the different probabilities in an acceptable manner, the WWC considers the randomization compromised. The WWC requires the analysis to account for the different probabilities because the intervention and comparison conditions can end up looking very different from each other if the study uses different probabilities to assign units to the groups. For example, in the scenario on the previous slide, 58% of the intervention group schools were making AYP, but in the comparison group, only 38% of the schools were making AYP. Those groups are not similar, but accounting for this difference in the analysis can address this issue. Studies can account for different probabilities in one of three ways. First, they can use inverse probability weights by applying weighting methods to rebalance the intervention and comparison groups. Second, they can use an indicator variable, also called a dummy variable, in the analysis for each subsample. In our AYP example, the researchers could use this method by including an indicator for AYP status. This basically signals in the analysis which schools are making AYP and which are not making AYP. Under the third approach, studies can estimate effects separately and combine them later. In the AYP example, the researchers could produce two impact estimates, one for the schools that were making AYP, and one for the schools that were not making AYP. Then they would average those to produce a single impact estimate. Using any of these three approaches would maintain the integrity of a randomization process with different probabilities. The randomized control trial is the only design eligible to meet WWC group design standards without reservations. That's because that randomization process gives us the highest level of confidence that the intervention caused the observed effect. However, not all RCTs are eligible for this highest rating. RCTs fall into two groups. The first group includes only the strongest RCT studies. To be eligible for the highest rating for group design studies, an RCT must meet two requirements. First, it must maintain the integrity of the random assignment. Second, the RCT must have low attrition, a concept we will cover in the attrition module, which is module 2. What if, by chance, the random assignment process did not produce groups that were similar at the start of the study? The study is still an RCT, and if it has low attrition, it is still eligible to meet WWC Group Design Standards without reservations. The second group of RCTs includes those not eligible for the highest group design rating. If a study has high attrition or did not maintain the integrity of the random assignment, then the study authors must show that the groups were similar on observable characteristics at the beginning of the study for it to be eligible for the next highest rating. We say the study must demonstrate equivalence of the analytic intervention and comparison groups to meet WWC Group Design Standards with reservations. We will talk more about equivalence in the baseline equivalence module, which is module 3. In sum, low attrition RCTs that maintain the integrity of random assignment are eligible for the highest rating, and high attrition RCTs and RCTs with compromised random assignment must demonstrate equivalence to meet WWC Group Design Standards with reservations.